Word up, 2 for 5s over here, baby. Word up, 2 for 5s, niggas got garbage down the way. Word up.
Cash rules everything around me. Green get the money. Dollar, dollar bill, yo.
All right, so first let's take a look at the patient's x-ray. So this right here, this is his total basis combium. I'm looking at it in blue sky bio. And it's number 21 that I want to place the implant into. And so my main concern at number 21 is this right here, this mental foramen. I want to make sure to stay far enough away from it. So let's go ahead and look at it in cross-section. So let's look at this one right here. I'm going to go up to number 22, and then we'll just slide backwards. Right? So we're sliding back to the number 22 site. So I'm going right to the middle, in between number, what is it, number 20 and 22. So this is the midway point right here, and this is some of that socket graft that was placed before. And so now I'm going to just measure with my little measurement tool, and measure the width here. It's 9.2 millimeters wide, and for sure that's enough room for an implant because I like to have a millimeter and a half facial, millimeter and a half on the lingual. So usually it's like minimum of 7 millimeters for a 4 millimeter wide implant. I'm gonna measure from here all the way down. We have a lot of room, but so it looks like 13 millimeters. But I want to find where that where the mental foramen is. So let's go back. So as I scooch back a little bit more, so it's just like at the distal portion of that edentulous space. And I'm gonna, so that's where it is right there. So that's where it's exiting, right? So the dental foramen is right here and the nerve exits through here. I'm gonna measure from that nerve to the crest of the ridge. And that looks like it's 13.8 millimeters. So I wanna stay a little farther away from it. We can place like an 11 millimeter implant or 10 and we'll still be safe. And as far as width goes, we can place a 4.3. We can place even wider, but for a premolar, I think 4.3 works out pretty nice. So that's about it. So let's look at the procedure. All right, so I'm just going to start off the case by giving local infiltrations with septicane. And I just go all around the tissue, just making sure that everything is nice and blanched. And that means he's going to be good and numb. And so I go ahead and make my flap with a 15C blade. So you guys already know by now, you just go along the crest of the ridge and just release that tissue on the crest, and then I carry that into an intrasulcular incision. So that just means I'm going around the teeth. So I just carry that incision right around the sulcus of the teeth and the distal, the mesial, and I make sure to carry that a little bit lingual too, so on the backside of the flap tooth. So I don't just carry the blade over once, I kind of go over it and over it in the same spots just to make sure the tissue is easy to release. All right, so now I'm just taking my little Woodson periosteal elevator. I use that to reflect my flap downwards. And so I'm peeling the tissue off of the bone. And I'm just gonna do that on the buccal and then on the lingual afterwards. So I take my time just making sure that I get all that fibrous tissue off of there, because sometimes, especially after you do like a socket graft or something, sometimes there's like a little bit of fibrous tissue just kind of hanging around the extraction site. So you want to clean all that up. So now I've cleared off the buccal tissue, and now I'm just sticking my instrument into the lingual and just kind of lifting that tissue off. You want to be really careful so your instrument doesn't slip, but you also do want to make sure that you lift it and that you're able to visualize that whole lingual border, so that way you'll know what the midpoint is to the bone. And actually I want to peel back my flap a little bit more, so I'm just going to do a small releasing back here at the distal, and then I'm going to do a small one at the mesial, and we'll be able to see everything a lot more clearly. Alright, so now I'm just peeling back that flap a little bit more now that I have the releasing incisions, and I'm going to slip my Minnesota in there and get ready to use the pilot drill. Alright, so now I'm just kind of looking at the buccal wall, lingual wall, and I want to see see exactly where the midpoint is so I can put my pilot drill. and there was a little bit of fibrous tissue there, so I'm just going to use my little instrument and just kind of scrape some of that off. And for this kit, I'm actually using the Implant Direct, they call it the Spectra kit. So it's a kit that allows you to place a couple different implant systems. So, I mean, a couple of different other product types. So that's the kit right there, giving you the thumbs up on it. So I'm just kind of going down the line from here, just going all the way down to like sequential drilling. So the first drill I'm using is their pilot drill. You can see it's different than the neodent drill, so I actually prefer the neodent pilot drill, but I mean this one works fine too. So I just use this and I go down about 6 millimeters or so and just kind of evaluate my angulation. Remember how I told you I always take x-rays after my pilot drill? So in this instance, this is like the only instance where I'm not taking an x-ray. So I'm moving on to my next drill size. The reason that I'm not taking an x-ray is because I can see that both of these roots are sort of divergent. And I mean, to play it safe, you totally should take an x-ray, but I feel really comfortable that I'm not gonna hit the roots. And I'm just showing you, I'm just kind of going down sequentially each drill that I'm using. But I'm taking it down to 10 millimeters because remember, you wanna avoid that that mental foramen. So then you wanna avoid the nerve, right? So I'm just going down to 10 millimeters with sequential drilling with that saline. And now I'm down to, I think I'm down to my last drill now, and I'm just scraping off that last little bit of, there's like some little fibers still there. So now I'm using my last drill. I believe it's undersized about 0.7 millimeters. And so I'm taking it to the top of that black line, which corresponds to 10 millimeters. And that's gonna be my last implant drill, but now I have to use this guy. So this is the little bone profiling burr. And so I'm using this bone profiling burr just to make the last little, it's the profile right at the crest of the ridge. If you don't use this, then you're more likely to get a spinning implant. So now I'm using the little insertion tool. I'm picking up my implant from that little case that they come in. And so that's what Implant Direct Interactive body looks like. So it's fairly aggressive threads, and it's got that conical connection. Actually, with Implant Direct, they have all kinds of different like bodies of the implants, but the interactive implant has that conical connection. So I use my handpiece to do most of the work. And at the very end, I can fine tune my, the depth of my implant. You can fine tune it with a little manual driver. And here I just make sure that I'm about a millimeter, maybe just a little bit more deep to the bone level. And after that, I'm gonna put a healing abutment. So I really like the convenience of Implant Direct that it comes with the healing abutments. My only gripe is that sometimes you need a taller healing abutment, and the one that it came with is a little bit shorter. And so the one I'm going to show you here is actually a little bit too short, I think, and the tissue might grow over it, and so that might be a little bit of a problem, but definitely the convenience is a huge thing. So now the healing abutment is placed, and now I just suture up the site with some PTFE sutures, and we're just going to wait 3 months before restoring. So here is the final x-ray. You can see that everything looks pretty good, and that implant is gonna heal up nicely.